Good morning, it's Friday, January the 27th, and you're tuned to TVAM. This morning we turn the spotlight on the Mays prison controversy. Should there be resignations in the wake of the Hennessy report? We talk to the minister in the firing line.
There are problems too in Britain's shipyards. We'll have an exclusive interview with the chairman of British Shipbuilders about the crisis in the industry.
As the weather continues to wreak havoc in the north of the country, we examine the effects on the household purse.
And we're meeting someone special this morning, one of the greatest footballers Scotland's ever produced.
But there are plenty of us who'd argue that Dennis Law isn't the only star guest, because we're also joined by Tim Pigott-Smith from the ITV production Jewel in the Crown. His star fantasy today is skiing, and there'll be plenty of volunteers, including myself, to jump over the moguls with him.
If you say so. What have you found in the paper?
It's really nice, even though the man he portrays in Jewel in the Crown is a real nasty piece of work. Very interesting, on the front page of the Daily Express, with the rather dramatic headline, The Exorcists, Prince and Princess Michael of Kent, it appears, have invited two priests, one Roman Catholic, one Anglican, into their new 300-year-old manor house home in Nether Lippiat, near Gloucestershire, or in Gloucestershire, maybe to exorcise a ghost there. Although they do insist, on the inside page here, that the spokesman for them insisted that it was a simple blessing of a new home. However, the former owner said he's the ghost that appears there is a very nice young man, charming, a young man who doesn't bother anybody. He's always been very amicable to me.
Oh, that's encouraging, isn't
it? It is, isn't it?
Another thing is very encouraging. Here's a story in the Daily Mail about our own problems here of a financial nature. AXA's Breakfast TV faces takeover. Actually, it talks about the fact that we've had problems with revenue recently. It doesn't mention the fact that a major part of the problem is the dispute between Equity, the Actors Union, the IPA, the Institute of Practitioners in Advertising. But
does it mention how many smashing people watch us every morning?
No, it doesn't, actually.
No, I bet it doesn't.
No. Yeah. But anyway, we are keeping our chins up, so worry not. Have I got time to mention one thing that amused me in the Star newspaper about a soldier called Alan Humphrey who had to do a Jeff Capes after a night on the booze, but his impression of the TV muscle man backfired. The Ford Escort he heaved off the ground was an unmarked police car. And as an added extra, there were two bobbies sitting in it.
Ooh.
Good one, isn't it?
Yes.
Jeff Capes actually used to do that when he was a policeman. I've known of times when he was driving along and saw someone with a puncture. That person hadn't got a jack and he actually held the car up while they changed the wheel. Great stuff, isn't
it? It's a useful man to have around.
Yeah, now you know who I model myself on.
Oh, yeah.
Wincey, good morning.
Good morning. Well, I'm not worried. I don't know about you two. The only thing that's worrying me is, why is it when you go to the laundrette, you always come back with an odd sock?
why is
I don't
that
know. Why
suddenly
is
struck
that?
You this morning?
Well, it's sort of a great mystery. I'm sure there's everyone up and down the country come back to the laundrette with an odd sock. Where do they all go? Who's got them all?
Thought for the day, isn't it?
Somebody invented a sock exchange.
Seems to be all right here, anyway.
Really? Oh, don't send me your odd socks, though, eh?
Sorry to trouble you, Wincey. Any chance of the weather forecast?
Oh, all right. I think so, eh? Right. This morning, actually, it's not as bad as it has been. There's some showers around in the south of England and farther north, lighter showers. Likelihood of a little bit of snow into the north of Wales and into the border regions, again, north of England and the border regions. Same pattern in Northern Ireland and the south of Scotland, but replaced by sunshine later on this morning, certainly. And the west of Scotland there is going to start quite bright, with more in the way of cloud down on the eastern side. And by midday today, well, temperatures cold again, but generally the western side there clearing up quite rapidly, and it should be quite a bright sunny day, with temperatures ranging from 2 in the extreme north of Scotland to 8 degrees in the extreme southern part. The eastern side much more likely to be wet for much of today, with lighter showers but not really particularly heavy rain there, and this rain moving across the country as the day goes on. North easterly wind over on the western side there, moderate wind, strong at times, but not too bad. And by 6 p.m. this evening, well, showers mostly clearing away, and another cold, clear, frosty night with quite a bitter northerly breeze blowing. Now back to Nick.
Thanks, Wincey. Let's look ahead to see what's coming up in the first half hour of this morning's programme. The checkout team will be taking a look at exotic fruit and microwave ovens. The Codfather will be bringing us his weekly angling tips. And we'll be visiting the villagers who've decided to sample life without television. That's all after the first news of the day from Gordon Honeycombe.
Good morning. There are growing calls this morning for the Northern Ireland Secretary James Pryor, as well as the province's prisons minister Nicholas Scott, to resign over the mass IRA breakout at the Mays jail in September. The governor of the Mays has already quit after yesterday's report detailing security lapses at the prison. But both Mr. Pryor and Mr. Scott have refused to go, despite strong pressure from many MPs. And last night, Mr. Pryor defended his decision not to resign. Henry Clark reports.
The Ulster Secretary said he would only have quit if the report had been critical of his policies. And he told a special news conference in Belfast, everyone is scraping and scratching around to try and find some definition of policy which would enable them to implicate me. But he said it would be wrong for either myself or Mr. Scott to resign. I rest on the report, said Mr. Pryor. But his statement is unlikely to satisfy loyalist MPs in the province who've renewed their resignation calls this morning. A special team is now being set up by the North Office to oversee the Mays Report's recommendations for improving security. Plans for a new prison to take many of Northern Ireland's convicted terrorists have already been delayed for several years. That delay is now likely to continue while security chiefs consider the lessons learned from the Mays breakout.
And a man has been shot dead in Northern Ireland. His body was found on a Catholic housing estate at Lurgan in County Armagh. Police say he wasn't connected with the security forces. Leaders of the civil service unions meet today to decide what action to take next over the proposed ban on trade unions at the Communications Centre in Cheltenham. The civil servants are threatening to bring government departments to a standstill, and protest walkouts throughout the country are expected today. Sue English reports.
More than 1,000 staff from GCHQ in Cheltenham voted by a large majority yesterday to reject the proposed ban. The government wants them to agree to give up their units or transfer to other establishments because of the threat to national security of industrial action at the highly sensitive communications centre. Meanwhile, union leaders are holding an emergency meeting today to decide on their next move. Campbell Christie of the Society of Civil and Public Servants says they'll consider calling for a day of action, which could bring government departments to a standstill. The stoppage would be timed to coincide with a debate in Parliament.
In snowbound Scotland, the weather is improving and conditions are likely to attract hundreds of skiers to the slopes. But as Bob Tomlinson reports, police are warning people to stay away for their own safety.
Police in Scotland have declared two ski centres as no-go areas as from midnight tonight. Grampian police will not allow skiers into the left area where 200 people were stranded last week. And police will set up a roadblock at Bairgowrie to stop skiers from going to Glenshee, where 2,000 people were stranded. In the Cairngorms, localised avalanche warnings are now being issued.
The Times newspaper won't be appearing today. News International, the company that owns the paper, has dismissed 750 members of the Sogat 82 print union. The move follows an unofficial strike begun 2 weeks ago by members of the clerical chapel, which other Sogat members joined yesterday. Representatives of the print union, the NGA, are appearing in court today in a bid to free £11 million worth of union assets seized during the Stockport Messenger dispute. The union has now abandoned its fight with Eddie Shah, owner of Messenger Newspapers, over a closed shop agreement. Most of the NGA's funds were seized by the courts because the union refused to stop unlawful picketing outside the Warrington Works. The House of Commons may today call on Mrs. Thatcher to declare her son's links with a £300 million contract which was awarded in Oman after she personally lobbied the Omani government. Her son Mark was in Oman at the same time as the Prime Minister in 1981. He was representing the British company, which was awarded the contract. The Speaker, Bernard Wetherill, has undertaken to rule on the issue after demands from the opposition. Labour MP Brian Sedgemoor, who's been leading the attack on Mrs. Thatcher, says the issue could threaten the government itself.
Well, if it turned out that there was £500,000 involved, either for Mark Thatcher personally or for his associates, then yes, I think the government could easily fall. It would be worse than the Marconi scandal which Lloyd George faced.
Finally, the Ministry of Defence has refused to confirm Rawdon's first astronaut will be a Royal Navy commander. ITN's News at 10 last night claimed that 40-year-old Commander Peter Longhurst would be the first Briton in space. A British astronaut is due to blast off next year in the American Space Shuttle, which will launch Britain's satellite Skynet 4. The Defence Ministry says that Commander Longhurst is the first choice among candidates from the Navy, but the RAF and the Army are also putting men forward. And that's the news at 6:35. Next news at 7.
And now it's time for the sport with Mike Morris. Good morning.
Good morning, Anna. Thanks very much indeed. I should start by saying, well, yesterday was certainly full of surprises in more ways than one. Alex Higgins was beaten by Tony Knowles by 5-1 in the Benson and Hedges snooker tournament at Wembley last night. And in boxing, Dennis Andrews of Hackney became the British lightweight champion in a somewhat controversial match. The Ridge Lyceum Ballroom was too small, so Andreas will almost certainly have to give the defeated champion, Tom Collins, an immediate return to satisfy the rules. In motorsport, Walter Rall continues to lead the Audi 123 on the Monte Carlo Rally, where the weather is just about the same as this country, lots of snow. But in the sunshine of the Middle East, competition favourite Scotsman Jimmy McRae retired from his first rally of the year in Qatar. His engine blew up. And at the other end of the world, down in New Zealand, the weather is the cause of more problems for the England cricket team. Heavy overnight rain, I'm afraid, has wiped out the first day's play in a three-day match against Otago. Also in New Zealand, Steve Cram has pulled out of tonight's meeting in Auckland, where he was to have run the mile. Once again, Cram's knee is the cause of the problem. Now, tennis, and Billie Jean King is unlikely to compete at Wimbledon this year. If she does, it'll only be in the doubles. And in table tennis, Desmond Douglas lost a match against singles match against Poland yesterday in the Norwich Union Open. And England completed a sorry day when they were beaten by the Dutch in the team competition. Well, today's play in the tournament gives the ladies a chance to show off their skills. Let's hope they do a bit better. Well, looking ahead to tonight's football, first the bad news. The second division match between Newcastle and Leeds is off. But the good news is that the Orient versus Wigan match should go ahead as planned. Now darts, and this weekend at London's Rainbow Suite, Eric Bristow will be aiming to take the British Open and get a treble never achieved in darts before. Bristow, you'll remember, has already won both the World Masters and the World Professional titles in the last month. But Bristow's is a scalp everyone is hunting for, and it's certainly a big scalp to take.
It's always been a big scalp, was the head, see? Yeah, but after you win the Embassy, everybody wants to be the first one to beat the Embassy World Professional Champion. As I say, this year I haven't lost yet, so if I can keep that going until about March, I've done very well.
Where's the motivation for you now?
Well, the motivation is every tournament that comes up is a different tournament, and it's a different year. I know I've won the British Open 3 times, but I want to win it 4 now. Like the Embassy next year, I want to make it 4, and you get greedy, don't you?
And in just over an hour's time, I'll be talking to the man who won the world title almost 12 months ago, and that was Keith Deller. Well, now racing, and not surprisingly, both of today's scheduled meetings have had to be abandoned. And the prospects for tomorrow look just as bleak. Air's already off, and Doncaster's having an inspection at 8 o'clock this morning. The only bright spot amongst the gloom is that Cheltenham is still on for tomorrow, but knowing the weather, that could all change over the next 24 hours. Well, let's end this morning's sport on a bright note. Yesterday's plans were announced to build a new super sports complex on land next to the National Exhibition Centre in Birmingham. The huge centre has been designed from similar complexes that exist in the United States. Called the Quadrina, the building will cover more than 15 acres, seat more than 66,000 spectators, and cost some £70 million. It's so large that it can accommodate just about any sport, with room for rugby, football and cricket matches, as well as athletic meetings on the 400 metre track. The design also allows seating to be removed quickly for concerts and pop groups. Well, we're always moaning about the lack of facilities. Great to hear that somebody's doing something about it at last. Back to you, Anne.
It looks wonderful too,
doesn't
it? Doesn't
it? Great, isn't it?
Wonder if there's room for a sports desk.
Looking for a job, Mike? Sorry. Yes, now let's get down to serious things. It's 2:11. Now it's time for our regular report from the checkout team. Here's Lynn Faulds Wood with our latest consumer news.
Hello. In checkout today, how to get your laughing tackle into queer gear. And I'll explain that in a moment. And to microwave or not to microwave, we'll be answering that question. But first, this stuff, queer gear as it's known in the trade. If your family's bored with apples and oranges, what about an exotic alternative? We sent Elaine Lipworth out to see whether queer gear just tastes queer or really exotic.
Exotic fruit there, we've got mangoes, papayas, avocados, sharon fruit, lychees.
This. Well, I've certainly never seen one before, and I wouldn't know whether to boil, bake or fry it, but it looks interesting, so I'm willing to have a go.
Papayas, yes, they're gorgeous.
Right, here we go.
another go at that one.
Yeah, that looks awful.
It looks awful, but it's very good, actually.
Caviar.
What's that?
Beautiful.
Just bite into it, all right. Mm. You know what it's like? It's very similar. I think I'm mad, like a golden russet apple.
Time of 50, seedless avocados. Come and see the night, man.
It's like
little banana.
Horrible. Go on, have a taste. Take a big mouthful.
I don't think they've quite got the hang of it. So how do you get into this stuff? Well, Elizabeth Lambert Ortiz has just written this mini book on the subject. Elizabeth, how do you get into this stuff? Take the orange one.
Yes, look, the mangoes can be awfully tricky and you can get really messy. So I worked out this system. You feel with the point of a sharp knife until you feel the seed, you see, and you judge it easily enough, and then you cut down a big slice like that, and you do it the same the other side. Now you can scoop that out with a spoon, but what you do then is you peel that seed and you pick it up and eat it and you get messy.
What about the unpleasant looking one with all the seeds in it?
That's pawpaw. And that is interesting. The Spanish-speaking world calls it papaya, and so do the Americans. But it is actually named for the pawpaw Indians of Jamaica.
How do you eat that?
Well, you scoop the seeds out like that, and then you squeeze a little lemon juice if you like it, or lime juice, a little sugar if you like it. And I don't think it's necessary. These are so beautifully sweet. And you just eat it with a spoon.
And you don't eat the skin of that again?
No, you don't eat the skin of that. Use the skin as a wee container. It just saves you scooping it out onto a plate.
Now, the little kiwi fruit I use, I put one of them on top of a fruit salad and it looks as if I've been generous and put it all the way through. How do you eat the skin of them?
No,
how
you peel them. I've cut it like that so as to show. But you peel it first and then you slice it and you get these delightful green slices with this terribly, terribly pretty pattern of seeds, which you do eat.
So wafer thin slices, and it looks like you spend a lot of money. How much cost?
Well, I've had them as cheap as 10p and as expensive as 50. And they do vary
as
the season comes in or as availability. And
lastly, this one's a new one on me. What is that?
It's new to me too, and very exciting and very pretty. It's called Sharon fruit, and it has a sort of honeyed flavor, and it comes from Israel, and I guess we'll be seeing a lot more of it soon, because we are getting exciting new things.
And do you think you eat the skin of that one?
No. You scoop it out. If I were making this in a fruit salad, I'd peel it
and use slices again,
and slice it or chop it.
Elizabeth, thank you very much indeed. Well, finally on Checkout today, we've got another of our Best Buy reports. This week, Jenny Webb on all you ever wanted to know about microwave ovens.
Microwave cookers have really caught on in the last year or two, and I'm sure most of us know at least one person that has one. But why are they so popular? Well, first of all, of course, they're very easy to install. All you need is a 13-amp plug. They can also be placed anywhere. They're very versatile, so you could have them positioned like this. And they're a cool appliance because there's no flames or elements, and consequently very useful on a hot summer's day or in a hot kitchen. It's a very economical appliance to use because it's so fast. It would only take about 20 minutes to cook a 3-pound joint in a microwave cooker, whereas with a conventional oven it would take nearly 2 hours. Microwaves pass through all materials as if they're invisible, with the exception of metal. So that means you can use for cooking plastics, paper, crockery, or even glass. You can use it for boiling an egg in its shell or for deep fat frying. Another question that a lot of people ask me is a microwave cooker safe? Well, yes it is. It's as safe as any other electrical appliance on the market. And indeed, it has two interlocks, and there is no way that microwaves can be generated once this door is open. There are three types of microwave cookers. The basic microwave cooker has a defrost control, a low wattage, and may or may not have a turntable. Then there's the medium technology cooker, like this one over here. That has a turntable, a higher wattage, and variable power control. And then you go on to the higher technology, like this one here, that has touch control, a memory, a temperature probe, and variable power, And there are others, with or two-level cooking even. So what should you look for when you buy a microwave cooker? Well, I would look for the BEAB label of safety, because this ensures that it's been tested to British standards for electrical safety and microwave leakage. The other point might be the timer. Now here, look at it, make sure that it's clear and easy to set. And another point, if you're looking at a microwave cooker with a turntable, then if you have a favourite dish, make sure that it fits into the cooker. A really useful tip, if you should buy a cooker or have one with a turntable and you happen to break it, whatever you do, replace it with the one that's supplied by the manufacturer, because this is a very special material and there is no substitute.
And that's it for this week's checkout. I'll be back on Tuesday with Alarm Call and an invitation into the activities of a national double glazing company. Join me then.
Thanks, Lynn. It's just gone 7:15. A very good morning to you if you've just joined us. You're watching TV AM. Now, with the sort of weather we've been getting lately, you might think it unlikely that many people will be out fishing for pleasure this weekend. However, anglers are a strange and hardy breed, particularly George Vella. And he's the codfather, of course. He assures me that he and many others will be wetting their lines as usual. Here he is to give us his usual tips this weekend. What about the hot spots, George?
Oh, well, first of all, this morning we go straight up to Blythe in Northumberland.
Yes.
We were talking about that last week. There's been some terrific fish caught off there again.
What sort?
Codling and plaice and dabs. So
yeah,
it's good fishing.
Yes.
Dropping down to Walton-on-Naze, which is Essex. There have been some lovely fish caught there as well.
Yeah,
there when the weather's... Weather's been really rough. I mean, the fish have been coming in 10 a penny again.
Mm-hmm.
That was the two hot spots. We're also going to give the Small River Roding in Essex as the chub venue of the year, really.
I mean, I have to admit, I've never heard of the River Roding.
No.
Disgraceful.
3 years ago, that river was polluted, and now it's come back to something that's absolutely amazing.
Yeah.
There's more chub in there than I've seen for years.
Mm-hmm.
We fished it 2 weeks ago and we had some up to £4.
Did you? And that's the main thing, is it, chub there?
Yeah, chub and dace. Beautiful fishing. Over to the River Medway in Kent, there's been some good bags of fish caught there again this week. Been some nice dace and there's also been some nice roach. So anybody who fancies fishing this weekend, give them places a try.
Yeah.
Whether you're course or sea anglers.
Yes. Now, you mentioned Blythe just now, and of course we talked about Blythe last week in connection with Don Payne, wasn't it? The
Don
disabled
Payne,
angler.
Yeah.
What's the latest start on
him? Well, the latest thing is they're going to review his case again on the 20th of next month, so we won't give him a raspberry yet. We'll wait till
just
they review
Just explain the story again about Don.
Poor old Don... who's in a wheel, can't get up to the pier to fish because he's got no car parking space to put his little car. And they would not give him permission to park his little car on the pier itself, which we all thought was disgusting.
Yes. So when you say they, it's the...
Blythe Harbour Commission.
Harbour Commission are going to look at the case again.
They're going to look at it again.
Yeah,
so
that's very encouraging.
Something done about it.
Yeah. Anyway, I mentioned just now that you're a strange breed and everyone can see that just by looking at you, George. What would you wear this weekend? You've got a fantastic array of stuff here. Is this the sort of thing you'd wear in the bad weather then?
Well, this is really good bad weather stuff.
Mm.
We went out yesterday to have a look around the shops to see what we could get, and we came up with some smashing stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And we went for value for money.
Yeah.
Going down from the bottom, we started picking, I mean, kids don't think about their thing, socks under £5, which is an absolute must.
Yes. Yeah.
We found these Ski-Tex boots under 25
really solid,
quid.
Don't they? Yeah.
And they're the ones they used in the Arctic expedition.
Oh, really?
Which was...
Yes, they're beautifully lined as well, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely. Guaranteed to minus 20 C.
Yeah.
Which is something unusual.
Yes.
And dry feet is the essence of everything.
Yes.
Going back to feet again.
Presumably you get a pair of these, do you?
Oh, yeah.
One
pitch
foot.
Yeah.
Isn't that encouraging? Yeah.
We went over to a really good pair of quality boots and we went over and to have a look at them. And the finest value for money and price, if you can look at them, they're virtually handmade.
Yes.
They're Regents. Absolutely smashing. And they're only £49.
Mm-hmm.
Which might sound a lot of money, but
they're pretty solid, aren't they?
They are really good.
And what's
going
that
over?
Enormous great thing? Is that a coat?
That is an all-in-one, wet weather gear.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's got that. He doesn't need anything else.
No, I shouldn't think he does.
If you can imagine, a good pair of boots and that,
mm-hmm.
and he doesn't need anything else at all.
Yeah,
superb. I mean, they're completely waterproof.
Yes, get your friends in.
Get someone
friends
in there with you as well.
Neighbours, yeah. That's marvellous.
Super.
Right, well, thank you for that, George. That's been very educational for me. I know what to wear if I go fishing this weekend. George, thanks a lot. We'll see you again next week.
Right, great.
Cheers.
Don't need to buy a sleeping bag if you've got one of those, do you?
Correct.
Terrific.
Just lie down.
Now, could you give up television? Well, no, we're not encouraging you to do it, but could you? Well, that's an experiment that a national newspaper, the Daily Mirror, has persuaded a small village in Devon to try out. Give up telly for a week, and we'll help your village hall fund, said the paper. Well, could the village do it, or would the families crack? From the quaintly named Peter Tavey in Devon, Brian Milton.
Without television, entertainment is a bit limited for the 300, the small village of Peter Tavey in Devon. You can't really walk in these conditions on the bleak Dartmoor hills, and Peter Tavey is halfway up a road that leads to nowhere. This is a village with a small village hall, one pub, mostly frequented by outsiders, a post office come shop, one church, one chapel, but no school, though there are lots of school children. The hall is the centre of community life, and it was by offering to make a donation towards its upkeep that the Daily Mirror persuaded most of this village to be TV-less for a week. But without Crossroads, without Top of the Pops, without Coronation Street, what are they going to do in the evening?
I'm playing snooker. My husband's got a small snooker table, so they've been doing that, pretending they're Cliff Thorburn and all these professionals.
Well, I've missed the sport. You know, that's, you know, I'm a sports fanatic. Anything on the television which is sport, I shall watch, you know, and I miss that.
OK, Jeff, why Peter Tavey?
Well, the Mirror was anxious to find anywhere in this country where a community would switch off, and I looked at several possibilities and really plunked for this one by luck.
Are you surprised at the reaction, so many people turning off?
I am, yes. And the majority of the people in the centre of the village have turned off, they've got their stickers up, they've got these stickers as well across their TV sets, and they're determined to stick it out to the end of the week.
Are you watching television these days?
No.
You're not? And what do you miss?
Grange Hill.
Just Grange Hill?
Grange Hill and Cotton.
So everybody here watches Grange Hill?
Yeah.
Isn't it too violent for you?
No.
There's intense speculation in Peter Tavey this week, deprived of its television, about what people are going to do with their evenings if they don't watch The Box. I mean, they weren't able to look at Crossroads last night and find out how Kath Brownlow responded to Liza Walters, bearing her all about her mother and her real background. So what did they do? Did they sneak a look at Top of the Pops to find out how that programme coped last night with not being able to put on the number one record, something apparently called Relax, because it was too sexy? Did they just happen with Steve Davis and Alex Higgins and the snooker championships and forget about their promise to be TV-less for a week? Or did they go to bed early and indulge in a more traditional form of communication?
That's good, isn't it? And if anyone's watching in Peter Tavey, good morning, and you're very naughty. Shouldn't be watching. I had a good holiday there once. Right, it's time for Lizzie.
Morning.
Hi, how are you?
Well, I'm awake. You're awake over there.
Nearly.
You know what I was thinking earlier? I was counting the days in January. What happened to your New Year's resolution? Do you remember saying, I'm going to get fit and I'm going to firm up a bit? Well, if you did make that resolution, I suggest you at least start today because it's Friday and it's the last morning of our very gentle exercises. You don't have to be getting really hot and sweaty and pounding away in order to get fit. We're using these bones and these muscles very slowly for control. So let's have some music. Still sitting there, join in on lots of stretches. And don't worry if you can't raise your leg as high as mine. Just start, and after a time, you will. So it's pushing through the feet and warming up the feet. And then it's feet apart to raise the arms, to stretch the back. Breathe in, up a stretch. And right out to the sides, and again. It's lovely to feel those bones in the back. Oh, really stretching. And out, because when you've been sitting slumped or not moving, those shoulders, the backs, you can really stretch. We're losing our cameras because all the cameramen are beginning to do it. Out, right up. Now raise your right knee and pull up your left leg to balance. Now up it comes. Why do we do this one? It's to release the hip and change and to get the thighs working as well. Before, and if you're a footballer, you have to do something like this. You go all the way down without falling over. Now push up through the thighs and place the heels and down again. Now right, legs apart, raise the arms and go to your right side. And I'll try and find the waist as you bend and go down. And up to your left. And over to your right. Right round. And to your left. Now for the back, keep the legs straight and flatten. And up. Try and get absolutely flat as you swing down. Now, hands on this your right side for the waist. So you go side, up, flat, and then to your left. So you're leaning to your side, finding that waist. And the one I forgot, your right hand down to your left toes, and then you change down. This is when you realize that you're not as supple as you used to be when you were little. Get right down, keep the legs straight. Now the right shoulder, circle it forward and round. Right round, but don't tense the neck as you do it. Forward and round with the left. And it's that backstroke for the swimmers, taking it forward and round. Right round, swing it round. This is helping the back as well. Right round. And a big stretch. Right round, head down, up to your left, and down to the right, and down again. Swoop it, and that final stretch of that right arm and the left. And you know, when you then give it a little push back next week, something totally different to watch. So see you then.
Thanks very much. She makes me ashamed, you know. And
not when surprised
when she said that oh, thank you. It's nice, isn't it, when she said, have you kept your New Year's resolution? I haven't even started mine.
I was going to
do Liz's exercise single day. Well, oh, February's a good day to
yes,
start
absolutely,
something,
yes.
Have you kept your New Year's resolution?
I don't think I had one, did I?
Well, that's a very easy way of keeping
like
it.
Yes. I'm running every day, keeping fit.
Yes, I believe you. What about you, Wincey?
Oh, I kept mine, yes.
What was yours?
Mine was to enjoy myself. Right, well, this morning, good morning. Actually, it's not as bad as it has been lately. There are some showers in the south of the country, moving northwards. Into North Wales, though, and northern England there, the showers are likely to contain a little bit of snow. Similar pattern on the border region, southern Scotland and into Northern Ireland. But this should soon be replaced by brighter weather. The northwest of Scotland starting off quite bright this morning, quite a bit of sunshine around. More in the way of cloud, likely on the eastern side. And still a moderate northeasterly wind over there. And on the eastern side of the country, moderate southwesterly wind to start the morning. By midday today, well, the temperatures aren't too bad, really. 2 degrees in the extreme north of Scotland and 8 in the south of England. Still quite cold feeling, though, because this wind is going to turn into the north later on today and make it feel fairly cold, but still bright. All down the eastern side of the British Isles, likely to see some, western side, likely to see some sunshine. Eastern side, much more likely to have showers, but lighter showers. And certainly the temperature is increasing slightly, and we're going to have some thaw of the snow. So the roads are going to be very wet today. So where there was frost and black ice yesterday, it's going to be very wet today. So equally a day to take care when you're driving around. By 6 p.m. this evening, well, rain moving across into the easterly direction, clearing almost everywhere apart from the extreme coastline, and clearer weather following on. Quite a lot of frost around tonight, so a cold night, wind turning into the north, and moderate fresh at times, and quite cold. That's it, back to Anne.
Thanks very much, Wincey. Now let's take a look ahead to the next hour of this morning's programme. The chairman of British Shipbuilders will be talking about the crisis in the nation's shipyards. We'll be finding out why the snow havoc is likely to lead to higher food prices, and meeting a soccer legend, Dennis Law. That's all after the latest news from Gordon Honeycombe.
There are growing calls this morning for the Northern Ireland Secretary James Pryor, as well as the province's prisons minister Nicholas Scott, to resign over the mass IRA breakout at the Mays jail in September. The governor of the Mays has already quit after yesterday's report detailing security lapses at the prison. But both Mr. Pryor and Mr. Scott have refused to go, despite strong pressure from many MPs. And last night, Mr. Pryor defended his decision not to resign. Henry Clark reports.
The Ulster secretary said he would only have quit if the report had been critical of his policies. And he told a special news conference in Belfast, everyone is scraping and scratching around to try and find some definition of policy which would enable them to implicate me. But he said it would be wrong for either myself or Mr. Scott to resign. I rest on the report, said Mr. Pryor. But his statement is unlikely to satisfy loyalist MPs in the province who've renewed their resignation calls this morning. A special team is now being set up by the Northern Ireland office to oversee the Mays Report's recommendations for improving security.
And a man has been shot dead in Northern Ireland. His body was found on a Catholic housing estate at Lurgan in County Armagh. Police say he wasn't connected with the security forces. Leaders of the civil service unions meet today to decide what action to take next over the proposed ban of trade unions at the communication centre in Cheltenham. The civil servants are threatening to bring government departments to a standstill, and protest walkouts throughout the country are expected today. Sue English reports.
More than 1,000 staff from GCHQ in Cheltenham voted by a large majority yesterday to reject the proposed ban. The government wants them to agree to give up their union rights or transfer to other establishments because of the threat to national security of industrial action at the highly sensitive communications centre. Meanwhile, union leaders are holding an emergency meeting today to decide on their next move. Campbell Christie of the Society of Civil and Public Servants says they'll consider calling for a day of action, which could bring government departments to a standstill. The stoppage would be timed to coincide with a debate in Parliament. Yesterday, Margaret Thatcher clashed sharply with Labour leader Neil Kinnaban. Mrs. Thatcher says she's willing to meet union leaders, but she stressed that she's not going to change her mind.
In snowbound Scotland, the weather is improving and conditions are likely to attract hundreds of skiers to the slopes. But as Bob Tomlinson reports, police are warning people to stay away for their own safety.
Police in Scotland have declared two ski centres as no-go areas as from midnight tonight. Grampian police will not allow skiers into the Lech area where 200 people were stranded last week. And Tayside police will set up a roadblock at Bear Gowrie to stop skiers from going to Glen Shee, where 2,000 people were stranded. In the Cairngorms, localised avalanche warnings are now being issued.
The Times newspaper hasn't appeared today. News International, the company that owns the paper, has dismissed 750 members of the Soget 82 print union. The move follows an unofficial strike begun 2 weeks ago by members of the clerical chapel, which other Soget members joined yesterday. Representatives of the print union VNGA are appearing in court today in a bid to free £11 million worth of union assets seized during the Stockport Messenger dispute. The union has now abandoned its fight with Eddie Shah, owner of the Messenger newspapers, over a closed shop agreement. Most of the NGA's funds were seized by the courts because the union refused to stop unlawful picketing outside the Warrington Works. The Speaker of the House of Commons may today call on Mrs. Thatcher to declare her son's links with a £300 million contract which was awarded in Oman after she personally lobbied the Omani government. Her son Mark was in Oman at the same time as the Prime Minister in 1981. He was representing the British company which was awarded the contract. The Speaker, Bernard Wetherill, has undertaken a call on the issue after demands from the opposition. Labour MP Brian Sedgemoor, who's been leading the attack on Mrs. Thatcher, says the issue could threaten the government itself.
Well, if it turned out that there was £500,000 involved, either for Mark Thatcher personally or for his associates, then yes, I think the government could easily fall. It would be worse than the Marconi scandal which Lloyd George faced.
Finally, the Ministry of Defence has refused to confirm reports that Britain's first astronaut will be a Royal Navy commander. ITN's News at 10 last night claimed that 40-year-old Commander Peter Longhurst would be the first Briton in space. A British astronaut is due to blast off next year in the American Space Shuttle, which will launch Britain's satellite Skynet 4. The Defence Ministry says that Commander Longhurst is the first among candidates from the Navy, but the RAF and the Army are also putting men forward. And that's the news at 7:05. Good morning.
Hello again. It's Friday, January the 27th. You're watching TV AM, and now it's time to join Jeremy Beadle for Today's the Day.
Hi, it's the 27th of January, and mighty musical prodigy Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart was born today in 1756. The son of a musician, at the age of four, he's supposed to have heard his first symphony and transcribed the complete score from memory. At five, he was composing the first of a lifetime total of over 600 works, and the following year, he was performing in the courts of Europe. He was such a frail and sensitive child, he would shake or even faint at the harsh discord. Kaiser Bill was born today in 1859, the son of the German Emperor and the grandson of Queen Victoria. But few people ever knew that his left arm was stunted and paralysed, and he worked fantastically hard to make his right hand extra strong. He had a massively powerful handshake, and because of this, it became a crushing experience to meet him. The inventor of Wonderland, Lewis Carroll, was born Charles Ludwig Dodson today in 1832. He was painfully shy and lived virtually as a recluse. The only company he really enjoyed was that of small children and small creatures. He especially liked worms because nobody else did, and he hated to think of them being eaten by ferocious snails and toads. So he designed and built a little armory of minute weapons so that his little friends could defend themselves. The world's first public demonstration of television was given by the Scottish inventor John Logie Baird in his London attic workshop today in 1926. 50 eminent engineers and scientists were assembled for the occasion, but they nearly walked out when they saw the apparatus. The base of the motor was a tea chest. Scanning discs were cut from cardboard, and the whole projection lamp was housed in a biscuit tin. The whole lot was held together with darning needles and sealing wax and string, and somehow it all worked.
Some engineers I know say it's a bit still like that as well. Right, we move on. In 2 weeks' time, Britain's shipbuilding workers tell their bosses whether they'll agree to the latest emergency scheme to keep the beleaguered industry afloat. This offers a £7 bonus in exchange for dropping time-honoured restrictive practices. It's vital to British shipbuilders' survival. Since the shipyards were nationalised in 1977, the workforce has been cut by more than a third. That's over 30,000 jobs lost, with 1,800 extra redundancies announced yesterday. Orders for future work are at their lowest since the 1930s, and prospects for new business are poor. British ships cost 35% more than some competitors, and important orders are being cancelled because British shipbuilders can't deliver on time. Well, with me now is the industry's most controversial figure, the man who is a saviour to some, but an axeman to others. Graham Day, chairman of the British Shipbuilders, good morning.
Good morning, Anne.
The union's decision could decide whether you go down in history as a saviour or an axeman. Which way do you think it's going to go?
I think it'll probably be a mixed review. I think it's important to note that the Shipbuilding National Negotiating Group has accepted, after prolonged negotiations, the program we've put to them. We've said that we must achieve the same levels of productivity and organize ourselves in the same way as our North European competitors. That, of course, begs the question about the Far East.
Yes, I was going to say, is that enough?
Well, it's enough en route. We have to realize that we as management have the responsibility to initiate and indeed to implement any agreement that's reached. And our initial target is, if you will, the near market in geographical terms. I think we must meet the North European competition, and we're determined to do that.
And then, presumably, you have yet another target to move towards.
That's
the
right. I think that we're all organized in a way that we want targets which we know are achievable. And then you simply go for the positive reinforcement to move on to the next objective.
How many redundancies will there have to be, and how many yards will have to close to achieve that, though?
The loss of jobs and the closure of yards is really driven by the market. And since I've come on, I've tried to demonstrate to everybody what the market is, how it operates, and indeed how we have to operate within that market. And in the short term, we're having to deal with a situation that has been inherited, and we have to tell people the truth, even though that truth may be unpalatable. And last week's exercise is part of that. I don't know what the end result will be, but we're also now moving more positively toward getting our marketing house in order and starting to push a sales program.
There is a lot to make up, isn't there? There are reports that to build a ship in Korea, you can do it for the price that would only cover the costs of material and equipment in Britain.
That's right. I believe that the Koreans are, as they say in supermarket terms, loss leading. But we know, going back to North Europe, that some of the competitors in North Europe are producing vessels at 30% lower man hours than we are. They're more effective purchasers, and they're low overall operations. And so across all our fronts, not simply on the manning side and capacity side, we're attempting to reorganize ourselves.
You have to deal with a traditionally very militant workforce. Are you a Mrs. Thatcher's axeman?
I was told I was an axeman when I went to Camelard and Birkenhead in 1971. In the event, after the first 3 or 4 months, we'd stabilized the workforce there, and all the time I was there, some 5 years, we were flat on 5,500 people. If an axeman was required, they've hired the wrong guy. What I am is someone who I believe can face the issues, tell people what they are, even though I don't like the telling and they don't like the hearing. Axemen know. If I didn't think I could make a positive contribution, I wouldn't have come.
What about dealing with each order as it comes? I'm thinking particularly of the loss of the Brit Oil rig, which is going to cost millions.
Yes, ma'am.
What are you going to have to fight for each order as it comes? Because necessarily, if you're closing yards, you're making people redundant, you're going to actually be able to build less ships.
I don't think it's a question of facilities. What we want to do is obviously build more ships in fewer facilities more efficiently. And that's the only way for survival and the only way we're going to be able to assure long-term employment.
And is there a future for the shipbuilding industry?
Well, I believe there is. I go from spending some time with you to breakfast with a ship owner because I know I can grab him between 7:30 and 9 o'clock this morning. We've had all our managing directors in merchant shipbuilding, their commercial directors and our marketing people closeted last weekend to get our new plans up and running. Sure, I think there's
sounds hope. Like a 25-hour job, Mr. Day. Thank
you
very much.
That's what I'm paid for. Thank you.
We'll take a break.
The new Orient Express and a new murder. The murderer covered her tracks with dazzling thoroughness on every surface. Wood, glass, metal. Would there be any clues left for our detective?
Mm-hmm. An extremely polished job. A brilliant shot. It has to be sparkle. But haven't they overlooked a clue?
Sparkle. Simply brilliant.
Cozy fits are cozy inside, cars are drier on the skin side, and that's what it's all about.
On TVAM this Sunday morning, Peter Adamson. As Fleet Street begins serialisation of his new book, Len Fairclough reveals all about the secrets, storms and scandals behind Britain's most popular television programme, and talks as never before on the way he really feels about its stars. And 3 years on from the Limehouse Declaration, we talk to the SDP's Bill Rogers and ask, where are they now? That's Bill Rogers and Peter Adamson, TVAM this Sunday morning.
Coming up to 7:15, this is TVAM. Good morning. For the last 10 days, the weather has dominated the news. Some of the worst storms in living memory have swept the country, with the north of England and Scotland bearing the brunt of it all. Bob Tomlinson reports now from the communication centre at Petrievi in Scotland, where all rescue operations from East Anglia to the north of Scotland have and are being directed.
The blizzards which have swept the country over the last 2 weeks have already claimed the lives of at least 11 people in Scotland alone. Thousands more have been trapped or stranded. It's here in a concrete bunker, hundreds of feet below me at Petrievi Castle in Fife, that the biggest search and rescue operation ever mounted in the north of England and Scotland has been coordinated. While I was there, another emergency call came in. It was from a ship off the east coast of England.
Petrievi Ops. Go ahead. Sinking vessel, Roger. Sinking. Position?
Would we like to copy the instructions?
5420 north.
That's right, mate. Yeah.
00 east west. 12 here, B. All copy. 5240 north. They're requesting immediate helicopter assistance.
Leckenfield are on their way.
Leckenfield, Bulmer coming with the Sea King.
Okay, what's the estimate for the Leckenfield crew? Have we got that?
3-5 minutes for Leckenfield.
Okay.
Bulmer will be slightly longer.
Okay. Squadron Leader Peter Bruce, can you tell us you have an incident on the go at the moment? Can you tell what's happening?
Yes, you can see the way this one has been developed with a call from the Coast Guard about the sinking fishing vessel. The immediate reaction was to get the Leckenfield helicopter from just north of Hull out to the scene. As more and more details come in, we've just found out that the crew is 12 on board, so we've got too many to get off with a single Wessex. So we're sending the Sea King helicopter, which is slightly larger as well, from Bulmer up in up north of Newcastle.
How much pressure have you been under since the storms began a week ago?
Since Saturday, really, when it all started and we started getting the calls for assistance, we've been very busy indeed. We've had additional helicopters come up from southern England to join us, and they have been employed over the last couple of days on delivery tasks, taking fodder out. We have been stretched, but we're just about coping.
Just how much pressure have we been under this time as opposed to other years?
For an example, last year we rescued 541 people. This year so far, and we're, 26th, 27th of January, we have picked up 149, and we're on our way to 12 more now. So that gives you an idea of just how many people we've had, how busy we've been.
And right now there's one group of people who'd welcome the sight of a helicopter bringing supplies. They're Britain's hill farmers, and for some of them a really bad winter means bankruptcy. The land they farm is bleak at the best of times, but heavy snow makes their tough job even more gruelling. The sheep may be scattered over hundreds of acres, may even lie buried in deep drifts. But for breeding ewes like these, a regular supply of food is essential. And that means crossing windswept country in the most treacherous conditions. And to add to their problems, the isolated farm cut off from contact with the outside world. Well, one man who knows all about these problems is Sidney Fawcett, who's a hill farmer from Yorkshire. You haven't been home for a while, have you?
No, I can't get home, I don't think. The roads are blocked. I got out and I'll get back sometime, hopefully. Mm-hmm. Yes.
So when did you last see your wife?
I haven't seen her for a few days now. Yeah. I hope she's fit and well and
that's Dorothy,
looking after the sheep, yes.
Yeah, well, you better say good morning to her.
Good morning, dear.
And look after the sheep.
Yes,
that's
it.
The order. Mm-hmm. Is it as serious as this? I mean, can it lead to bankruptcy, the bad weather?
Well, of course, there's always that possibility, but it's far too early to say yet, you know, how serious it really will be, because if this weather continues, and looking at that weather chart and the frost tonight means that there's no proper thaw coming yet, obviously, you know, it means if it goes on for a few weeks, we eat further and further into our inroads, you know, make inroads into our stocks of hay.
Yes.
And you know, it costs more and more and more, and the sheep get more and more run down. But if it goes away quickly, no trouble, really, at the end of the day, it'll be all right.
I think something that upsets a lot of people, see pictures on television, is of sheep, for instance, sort of stuck in the snow, even buried in the snow.
Yes.
I mean, how do you set about finding them when you're in that situation?
Well, I can appreciate that, but people have got to realise that sheep are used to these conditions, you know, although we don't like them floundering about in deep snow, but they are used to it. What you do, of course, you try and get a count, which is impossible on really bad days, but when it's quiet, try and get a count, see how many you're missing, and then go looking for them with dogs. The sheepdogs are very good at sniffing them out.
Even in the snow?
Oh, yes, yes, very good. Mm.
What sort of precautions can you take against this sort of weather?
Well, we've had a fair bit of warning this time, because there was snow lying about for, you know, about a week or more before the really heavy falls came, and of course the hill ewes, the sheep, were dropping in from the higher ground onto the probably more sheltered areas. So, fortunately in my case, you know, they're there and they're being fed, but you can be sort of caught unawares on occasion, you know, or there may be a change of wind might blow the sheep out into the open again, but as I say, I'm not too worried yet.
Yeah. Briefly, is there an effect on the consumer when you get this sort of weather?
Not at this stage, there ought not to be. These are breeding sheep, of course. They're not sheep that are going to be eaten shortly. They're the breeding stock. Obviously, it could have some effect on the lambing percentages later on next spring. It may mean there are a few less British lambs about, but there'll be plenty of lambs, don't you worry. The consumers will have plenty to go at.
Well, Sidney Fawcett, thanks very much for talking to us, and good luck. I hope you get home.
Yes, so do I. So do I.
Have a good weekend if you make it.
Yes,
thanks a lot.
Thank you.
We'll take a break.
A big cough needs strong treatment. Hill's Balsam Pastels. Hill's for long-lasting relief.
New turkey steaks from Matthews Norfolk Farms. They're beautiful! At around 89 pence for four, the price is beautiful too.
Hey, did you know there's a free pop sticker in every special pack of Shreddies? With six to collect, all our favourites are there. So get your pop stickers free. Look out for us on the Shreddies pack. Shreddies, squarer than the average breakfast.
New Sinutab. Fast relief from sinus congestion, headache, and pain.
Sinutab.
ready tonight.
That's good, isn't it? Isn't that good?
Only for the weekend.
Jolly good. Alice, you let your mother know if anyone arrives unexpectedly. She always says the house is in an awful mess. Look who's here.
It's an awful mess.
Wayne's got a new partner at 9 in Alphetosane Pet.
We have a really good cover story for you, won't we?
Oh, yeah, there's McAlpines and Wimpy's, and then there's Osborne and Son, that's us.
In the meantime, you are just one of the boys.
Look again, Pet, one of the men.
Put a smile on your face with these two programs tonight on ITV.
It's just gone 7:20. A very good morning to you. You're watching TV AM. Now, tomorrow, football sides around the country meet for battle in the fourth round of the FA Cup, a crucial time for soccer players. So a good moment to look at the current state of play with two great professionals. This morning, we've brought together the rare talents of ace striker Dennis Law and our own football and TV wizard, James Greaves, who's looking absolutely staggered by my remarks. Here to remind you of the magic days that have gone by of some classic goals from Dennis Law.
And Herbie doing that one slip, and Law now for Gowling. Still Gowling, Law, and a goal! 2-1, Dennis Law. Law was saying he wants it in the air, so too does Gowling. And Law, in fact, with an overhead kick, and it's there! And Wall, through the legs of Morgan to Taylor. Tamley, Owen Parents beating him. Played there for Law, and number 5! Number 5, Dennis Law.
Quite good, aren't you?
It's a long time ago, isn't it?
You retired, what, 74?
Yes.
And didn't you say at the time you'd never kick another ball in earnest? And you haven't kicked a ball since at all, have you?
No, I didn't, no. I played a couple of testimonial games after I finished. But, you know, when I did finish, I said that's it professional-wise. Because to be a professional player is very difficult, you know. You've got to train all the time. And I think training was one of the hardest things to do. So when I, you know, eventually called it a day, that was it. I mean, Greavesy still plays on, don't he?
No.
No?
No.
But, I mean, you did play
called
on.
Called it a day.
You played on for quite a while.
Oh, I went non-league, yeah.
Well, I didn't fancy
but
that.
But they don't play football down there, they just kick each other.
What did you play for?
I don't know. Just the fun of it.
Not
you,
the money,
you
obviously.
You two, certainly in my eyes, are very much of a kind, sort of outstanding goal scorers. Do you, I mean, it's an embarrassing question this, but do you have a great mutual respect for each other?
Well, personally, I mean, I don't know what Greaves is going to say, but for me, anyway, Jimmy was the best striker that I've ever seen. And that included, you know, in the 60s and into the 70s, you know, Pelle and Puskas and Di Stefano. I mean, these were all great players, but for me, Greaves was probably the best. He was lazy.
Yes.
I mean, he didn't do a great... many other things.
I've got to come in here, Nick, because I felt the same admiration for Dennis, and it was quite amazing throughout our careers, the press and television, because we were sort of north and south and rivals, they tried to get us at it,
and
they tried to get us to criticize each other, and we wouldn't at any given time, because Dennis was my favorite football Dennis was my favorite footballer of all time. Yeah. And it's quite amazing. I've got two, really. There's Den and Bestie.
Yes.
And the two of them, to me, were completely on their own. That's right.
This is embarrassing.
It is embarrassing. There's no one watching, though, so don't worry about it.
No,
and of course, you also shared experiences in that you both went to Italy.
Yes, Jimmy, I lasted a bit longer than James. I stayed about... I stayed about...
This is Torino.
Just over a year.
Yeah.
Well, you came back after about 3 months.
Did you both know that? I mean, I know you regarded Italy as an unhappy time, didn't you?
Well, it was unhappy for me because I was on my own. I think Dennis had a slight buffer, although it was unhappy for him, in as much as that he had Joe Baker with him.
Of course,
yeah. Because they finally had to crash their car to get home, but he managed
to... Yeah, Joe crashed the car, yes. He had a couple of lagers, a couple of shandies. Mm. But Jim was married. I would think that if I had been married at the time, I would have been back much quicker. Because we had been used to playing in, you know, English football and good football and attacking football. When we went to Italy, the money was far greater than we were getting here, but the football was awful. Mm-hmm. You know, they played with, what, 9-10 people back.
Is that a great argument, then, for the quality of life being more important than the money you earn?
Well, I think so. You know, it's the old saying, you know, if you're not happy, then it doesn't really matter how much more you're earning. You know, you don't enjoy it, and I certainly didn't enjoy it. But looking back on it now, you know, the money, I did miss the money. Mm-hmm. And maybe I should have stayed.
It's about 24 years or 23 years ago this weekend, roughly, fourth round of the FA Cup.
You'd remember it, Nick.
You knocked in roughly seven goals in a cup tie and still ended up on the losing side.
Yes, the...
I bet that's a great memory for you.
The I'm not a great lover of referees. but the referee was absolutely hopeless. And with 20 minutes of the game, in the first game, where we were trailing 2-0, and when we eventually were leading 6-2.
After 69 minutes, wasn't
it? The fool decided to abandon
game. You'd scored all six.
And then the replay on the Wednesday, you know, we knew before we went out that we were going to get beat. Mm. And we got beat 3-1.
But you scored that one, didn't you?
Yes, I did. We're going back a long time. You know?
Yes, well, I had a teacher at school who was a great Manchester City supporter, and when he heard the score, Luton 2, Manchester City 6, he leapt up in the air. Then he heard abandoned after 69 minutes, and that was the first time I ever heard a certain four-letter word, because he wasn't very impressed. So I learned a certain four-letter word off a school teacher. Anyway, we'll chat again in just a moment. Thanks, Dennis and Jim.
I don't understand football, but aren't they smashing people? Now it's time for the brand. Today's dedication is an unusual one. It's from Claire, Michael and Mummy Sarah. And they write, "Our daddy watches TVAM with us every morning, and although he's grown up, we have a picture of him when he was little. His name is Roger Maruzzi. He's changed a lot. He's 44 today and lives in London. So here for you, Roger, are the Fraggles, and weren't you a gorgeous little boy?"
What should he do to make Lou love him?
Well, young Fraggle, love is not found in the market. It's not found under any bush, I can tell you.
I think I should just forget the whole thing and go home.
No, it's found right here. Now, come on, boys. Where are those love potions? Help me find the stuff.
The stuff. Which stuff, Marjorie?
Number 6.
How about number 27?
No, boys. I want the real stuff. Number 9.
Not number 9?
Oh, not number 9. Whatever it is.
Here you go. This is a powerful love potion. One sniff and your Lou Fraggle will love you like crazy. Listen to this. Lover, number 9. Don't you pout, don't you mind. She will love you every time. Lover, number 9. Come on, Chrissy. Lover, number 9. Don't you pout and don't you mind. She will love you every time. Lover, number 9.
This is sort of my guess.
Oh, I love that one. Hasn't he got soul, the compost heap? Right, Jimmy's looking at that in more detail later. Right, this morning, we're starting at 6 o'clock. Look at this. Well, I'll do the weather in reverse order, just like Miss World. Right, tonight there's going to be a lot of frost about. And it's going to be raining on the eastern coast, but the rest is going to be clear. And we'll go back this way, because I haven't got time to do it any other way. And now, on the eastern side, much more in the way, western side by midday, certainly a lot of sunshine around. 2 degrees in the extreme north, getting down to up to 8 degrees in the extreme south. This wind increasing as the day goes on and veering into the north, so it's going to feel quite cold, but generally very bright, particularly on the western side of the country. And this morning, if you're just getting out of bed, this is what you're going to find. A bit of snow around, that will disappear, replaced by sunshine in many areas, rain in the south, moving northeastwards and disappearing. Right, back to Nick.
Thanks, Wincey. And coming up before 8 o'clock here on TVAM, we'll be meeting darts heartthrob Keith Deller. We'll be discussing the inquiry into the Mays prison escape, and finding out how a group of Devon villagers have coped during a week without television. But right now, the latest news at 7:30 with Gordon Honeycombe.
The Northern Ireland Secretary, James Pryor, is facing growing pressure to resign over the mass icard from the Mays prison in September. The prison governor has already quit after a report detailing security lapses at the jail. Both Mr. Pryor and the province's prison minister, Nicholas Scott, have refused to go despite pressure from MPs. Henry Clark reports.
The Ulster secretary said he would only have quit if the report had been critical of his policies. And he told a special news conference in Belfast, everyone is scraping and scratching around to try and find some definition of policy which would enable them to implicate me. But he said it would be wrong for either myself or Mr. Scott to resign. I rest on the report, said Mr. Pryor. But his statement is unlikely to satisfy loyalist MPs in the province who've renewed their resignation calls this morning. A special team is now being set up by the Northern Ireland office to oversee the May's report's recommendations for improving security.
And this morning, the body of a man was found on a Catholic housing estate at Lurgan in Northern Ireland. He'd been shot. Leaders of the civil service unions meet today to decide what action to take over the proposed ban on unions at the government's secret communications centre in Cheltenham. As Sue English reports, they're threatening to bring the civil service to a standstill.
More than 1,000 staff from GCHQ in Cheltenham voted by a large majority yesterday to reject the proposed ban. The government wants them to agree to give up their union rights or transfer to other establishments because of the threat to national security of industrial action at the highly sensitive communications centre. Meanwhile, union leaders are holding an emergency meeting today to decide on their next move. Campbell Christie of the Society of Civil and Public Servants says they'll consider calling for a day of action, which could bring government departments to a standstill. The stoppage would be timed to coincide with a debate in Parliament.
In Scotland, the weather's improving and snow conditions are now likely to attract hundreds of skiers to the slopes. But as Bob Tomlinson reports, police are warning them to stay away.
Police in Scotland have declared two ski centres as no-go areas as from midnight tonight. Grampian police will not allow skiers into the left area where 200 people were stranded last week. And Tayside police will set up a roadblock at Bear Gowrie to stop skiers from going to Glenshee, where 2,000 people were stranded. In the Cairngorms, localised avalanche warnings are now being issued.
The Times hasn't appeared today because of a union dispute. 750 members of the print union Sogat 82 were dismissed following an unofficial strike. And representatives of another print union, the NGA, appear in court today in a bid to free £11 million worth of union funds. The money was seized during the dispute with Eddie Shah, owner of the Messenger Group of newspapers, after the NGA refused to obey a High Court order banning unlawful picketing. Well, that's the news at 7.33. Next news is at 8.
And now it's time for the sport. Here's Mike Morris.
Thanks, Anne. In fact, we'll be meeting one of your old darts partners soon. But
yeah, I didn't know I was a darts player, did you?
We'll have to find out about that. Anyway, let's get on with the sport. And yesterday was certainly full of surprises in more ways than one. Alex Higgins was beaten by Tony Knowles by 5-1 in the Benson and Hedges snooker tournament at Wembley last night. And in boxing, Dennis Andreas of Hackney became the British lightweight champion in a somewhat controversial match. The ring at London's Lyceum Ballroom was too small, so Andreas will almost certainly have to give the defeated champion, Tom Collins, an immediate return fight. Would you believe it? The original ring was nicked. In motorsport, Walter Rall continues to lead the Audi 123 in the Monte Carlo Rally, where the weather is just about the same as this country. Lots of snow. But in the sunshine of the Middle East, Scott McRae retired from his first rally of the year in Qatar. He was favourite, but his engine blew up. And at the other end of the world, down in New Zealand, the weather is the cause of more problems for the England cricket team. Heavy overnight rain has wiped out the first day's play in a three-day match against Otago. Also in New Zealand, Steve Cram has pulled out of tonight's meeting in Auckland, where he was to have run the mile. Once again, Cram's knee is the problem, I'm afraid. Tennis and Billie Jean King is unlikely to compete at Wimbledon this year. If she does, it'll only be in the doubles. And in table tennis, Desmond Douglas lost his singles match against Poland yesterday in the Norwich Union Open. And England completed a sorry day when they were beaten by the Dutch in the team competition. Well, today's play in the tournament gives the ladies a chance to show off their skills, and good luck to them. Looking ahead to tonight's football, first the bad news. The second division match between Newcastle and Leeds is postponed. But the good news, Orient versus Wigan game should go ahead as planned. Well, now racing, and not surprisingly, both of today's scheduled meetings have had to be abandoned, and the prospects for tomorrow look just as bleak. Air's already off, and Doncaster is having an inspection at 8 o'clock this morning. The only bright spot amongst the gloom is that Cheltenham is still on for tomorrow. Knowing the weather, all that may change over the next 24 hours. Well, now darts, and this weekend at London's Rainbow Suite, Eric Bristow will be aiming to take the British Open and get a treble never achieved in darts before. Bristow, you'll remember, has already won both the World Masters and the World Professional titles in the last month. But Bristow's a scalp everyone is hunting for, and it's certainly a big scalp to take.
It's always been a big scalp, was the head, see? Yeah, but, yeah, I suppose after you win the embassy, everybody wants to be the first one to beat the embassy world professionals. And, as I say, this year I haven't lost yet, so if I can keep that going until about March, I've done very well.
Where's the motivation for you now?
Yeah, well, the motivation is every tournament that comes up is a different tournament, and it's a different year. I know I've won the British Open 3 times, but I want to win it 4 now. Like the embassy next year, I want to make it 4, and you get greedy, don't you?
Eric Bristow, the man with the darts world at his feet, but just over 12 months ago, it was a new name on everyone's lips who beat Bristow to take the world title. But since that time, Keith Deller seems to have rejoined the also-rans, and he's with me in the studio today. Keith, let's start with the good news. What has that title done to change your lifestyle in the last 12 months?
Well, it's changed me a lot, really, from being just one of thousands who love playing darts to one of the top players in the world.
Let's get on with the bad. In the last year, you've played in 15 tournaments, I think it is, and only 2 tournament wins. What actually has gone wrong?
Well, it's always hard to say where you've gone wrong. I have been playing well all year, and I think really due to a lot of travelling hasn't helped as much. And you don't play and practice as much as you can. And really, Eric's the only one that has won more than 2 tournaments this year.
Well, Eric seems to loom large. I must inflict a quote from him on you. He says, you aren't good enough to be world champion. You haven't proved you can handle the pressure. And he gives you only a 50-50 chance of surviving the big time. What have you got to say to that?
Well, that's always Eric's opinions. He always, I think, says too much. And it's his opinion. I know that I'll be around here for a long while. And I've beat Eric 3 times out of 5 this year, so I'm not worried too much about Eric.
There's a shot of you playing here and scoring a pretty handsome score. As your what kind of pressure have you been under in the last 12 months?
Well, it's always hard because you're the world champion and you're expected to win. And, you know, it's a question of being able to take the pressure. I can take the pressure.
Well, that's good news, but I must come up with one extraordinary quote from you. It says, I'm sure love can put you back on top. What exactly do you mean by that?
Well, I think it's usually the newspapers blowing up a little bit. You know, I always say that you're supposed to be going out with 10 girls at a time, and it's just been blown out of just that the girl I'm seeing, she's a nice girl, and they'll think that I'm in love and I'm going to get married soon, which I ain't at the moment anyway.
So no time for 10. Keith, thanks very much for coming in. Whatever's happened in the last 12 months, we certainly wish you the best of luck in the next 12.
Thanks
for coming in.
Anne. Thanks very much, Keith, for being my partner together on the Christmas Day edition of Bullseye. It was terrific, wasn't it?
Great, yeah.
And we did awfully well, and it wasn't because of me. Right now we're going to break.